So we're starting now?
Yes.
Is that, yeah?
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay, so thank you for inviting me and thank you all for coming. I guess I should I put this up? Is this all right the way it is? Yeah, okay. So, well, I think maybe I should just get started on the slides since we have lost some time here. So, okay, so first thing I have is some historical perspective. In 1971, the U.S. Office of Naval Medical Research issued a report listing various health effects produced by exposures to microwave frequency electromagnetic fields, which we abbreviate EMFs. And in that, they listed over 100 different effects produced by low-intensity non-thermal exposures. So these are exposures that are not produced by heating and are produced by low-level EMFs that produce essentially no heating at all. And these included 40 different what can be considered to be neuropsychiatric effects. So these include changes in brain structure and function, changes in various types of psychological responses, and changes in behavior. It included 8 different endocrine, that is, hormonal effects, including both amino acid-based hormones and also steroid hormones. It includes cardiac effects, which influence the electrical control of the heart, including changes in the ECGs, and producing arrhythmias. And arrhythmias, as you may know, are often associated with sudden cardiac death. So these can be very serious. And can be life-threatening. Chromosome breaks and other changes in chromosome structure. Histological changes in the testes. So this is where you're looking at an animal testis where the animal's been exposed to these EMFs and where the structure, the cellular structure of the testis has changed in substantial ways that you can examine under a microscope. Cell death, what is now called apoptosis, a process important in neurodegenerative diseases and also a number of other diseases. All of these things were going on and were documented in 1971, 45 years ago. And the Naval report also provided approximately 2,000 citations, so there's 2,000 studies that have looked into one or more of these things, that document the various non-thermal health effects of these low-intensity microwave frequency EMFs. So this was already known in ancient past, So following that, there have been dozens of other reviews that have documented non-thermal effects of various sorts. And there are thousands of primary literature citations, so primary literature meaning specific studies, that also document these reports that have come out since 1971. And so among the effects that have been repeatedly documented since 1971 include lowered male fertility, including lowered sperm quality and function, and also lowered female fertility. Female fertility has been less studied. It's much more difficult to study, but it has been studied, and it seems to be lowered fertility also seems to be going on in females. And there are also reports of high levels of spontaneous abortion after exposures. Okay, so some of these are animal studies, some of these are human studies. Oxidative stress has been reported in many, many, many studies following exposures. Cellular DNA damage has been reported, again, in many studies. Those include single-strand breaks in the cellular DNA. They include double-strand breaks in cellular DNA. And they also include 8-hydroxydeoxyguanosine, that's that 8-OHDG, in cellular DNA, and that can cause mutations of various sorts. So cancer, which is likely to be to involve these DNA changes, but it's also been shown recently that tumor promotion-like effects also occur in response to EMFs. And so that's another aspect of this that seems to be involved in causing cancer. There are widespread neuropsychiatric effects, including depression. I published a paper on that last year that extensively documented this in response to a wide variety of different types of EMF electromagnetic fields. So not just one kind of field, but many, many types of exposures. And therapeutic effects. There are genuine therapeutic effects of these fields when they are at an appropriate level and when they're focused on an appropriate part of the body. And those include stimulation of bone growth, which is the therapeutic effect that's been most studied, but there are also quite a number of others. Cataract formation has been argued to be a thermal effect. In fact, the literature is very clear that it's not a thermal effect. It's caused by non-thermal effects, and in fact, it's apparently caused by the mechanism that I will discuss later on in this talk. Now, breakdown of the blood-brain barrier, something again, it's been reported over and over and over again. So melatonin depletion and sleep disruption, another thing that's been reported over and over and over again. So basically all of these, you know, all of these things have been reported in many, many studies. And despite all the evidence for non-thermal effects, our current safety guidelines and standards are all based on the assumption that only thermal effects need be of concern. So in last year, in 2015, there was an appeal to the United Nations and all the member states that was signed by 206 scientists from 40 different countries. The appeal stated that the current safety guidelines and standards are inadequate because they don't take into consideration non-thermal effects. The 206 scientist signers all had published peer-reviewed scientific papers on the biological effects of EMF. So these are not just ordinary people or ordinary scientists. These are all people, scientists who are deeply engaged in this area of science. And all of them say that the safety guidelines and standards are inadequate and that there are non-thermal effects of these fields. So I think that, then the scientists who signed these collectively have published over 2,000 such papers. Okay, so there's a large body of science which supports these views. And so there should be no question that there is an international scientific consensus on the existence of non-thermal health effects and the inadequacy of the safety guidelines and standards. Okay. Now, how does all this work? How do these non-thermal effects get produced in our bodies? And I stumbled onto the answer that explains most of them in 2012. And I've subsequently published 5 papers documenting the mechanism that I think is the central mechanism that's involved. These papers are listed here. This is a 2013 paper, the first of them. This was honored by being placed on the Global Medical Discovery website as one of the top medical papers in 2013. And it's been highly cited already, so there's a substantial amount of interest in it in the scientific community. Here's another one that was focused strictly on the therapeutic effects. Here's a another paper which has actually a lot of different things, which you can kind of tell from the long title, and I'll talk about some of the implications of this paper later on. And then I published this paper on the production of widespread neuropsychiatric effects. I mentioned that before. And then finally, there's a paper here that's aimed at industry, basically giving my scholarly advice about what industry should be doing.
There's not sufficient space on the screen.
Well, I think actually this thing is cut off.
Okay.
So it's my fault, not the screen problem. Okay. So I think so. Yeah. So how are non-thermal effects produced? There are 26 different studies that have shown that non-thermal effects of microwave and also lower frequency EMFs can be blocked or greatly lowered by using calcium channel blockers. I'm getting some feedback on here. I guess I'll lower it and see if that'll work. Is that okay? Okay. So, no, it's still coming in. Let me turn it down. Okay. Is it coming? Can you hear me? No, it went off.
No.
No, maybe I'll just put it closer. Okay, let's try that. Okay, so we have 26 different studies that show that non-thermal effects of microwave and lower frequency EMFs can be blocked or greatly lowered by calcium channel blockers. These are drugs that are specific for blocking what are called voltage-gated calcium channels, and we abbreviate these VGCCs. And there are five different types of calcium channel blockers with different structures that bind to different sites. And the only thing that we know of, and these are all thought to be highly specific, that they do is they all block or the calcium channel, the VGCCs. So they're blocking these channels. And what that tells you is that EMFs act by activating the VGCCs and allowing calcium ions to flow into the cell, such that most, if not all, the biological effects are produced by this excessive calcium in the cell. Okay, so everything seems to be going through these VGCCs, or at least most things, let's put it that way, and you can therefore block them with these calcium channel blockers. And a lot of these studies have been done in cell culture, and of course one of the problems with using these in the human body is that when you use high doses of them, they have many different side effects, that because these channels of course have important functions in our bodies. Mm-hmm. So it's not clear that these are going to be useful in terms of preventing these things in real life human beings, but they certainly do prevent these things in cells and culture, and also in animal studies you can show that that's true as well. So it's not only the microwave frequency EMFs that produce this VGCC activation, it's also the extremely low frequency fields from our power wiring. And so 50 hertz, 60 hertz EMFs also do this. The main concern is with the microwave frequency thing, because of course our exposures are skyrocketing. They just keep going up and up and up with absolutely no sense that we're damaging our bodies. Now, it doesn't mean that there are not effects from our power wiring. In fact, I'm sure there are that have health effects as well. But at least our exposures to those are not skyrocketing at this point. Now, there are five different additional types of evidence that each provide further support for this mechanism of action for the non-thermal EMF effects. And we only really have time to talk about one of these, and I'm just going to talk about the most important of them, because, you know, we have limited time here. So, the VGCCs, and also there are some other voltage-gated ion channels. So these are regulated in the normal physiology in our body by the charge across the plasma membrane. So that's a normal physiological regulation that regulates the opening and closing of these channels. And so, and there's a structure in them that detects those electrical changes across the plasma membrane, and it's called the voltage sensor. And so what I'm going to argue is that the voltage sensor, because of its structure and because of its location in the plasma membrane, is extraordinarily sensitive to these electrical effects. I'm going to argue that that's the reason why the voltage sensor is the primary and possibly the sole target of these low-intensity EMFs. And now, industry acknowledges something that's been known basically since the time of World War II, and that is that microwave and lower frequency EMFs can put forces on charged groups. So if you have a positively charged molecule or part of a molecule in your body, either positive or negative, these EMFs can put forces on that. They can push it or pull it back and forth. And so this has been known since the end of World War II. And it's also been known that this is the way microwave ovens cook your food. Okay, so basically what you're doing is you're joggling charged groups around in your food at very high rates, and that heats the food, and that's what cooks it. Okay, that's the way microwave ovens work. What industry argues is, yeah, that's true. We know that's true, but the forces of these very low-intensity fields are too weak to do anything. That's the central argument which they make. It's a substantive argument, okay? As I'm going to show you, it's wrong. So they argue that these low-intensity EMFs are too low to produce any biological effects because they're too weak to put high enough forces on these charged groups. Okay. Now this is the structure of the voltage sensor, and I'm sorry, I seem to have lost my pointer. But if you look at these cylinders in the slide, each of those cylinders is an alpha helix, which is more or less going through the plasma membrane. Okay, so these are all in the plasma membrane, the outer membrane of the cell. If you look at these, you can see on the top, you can see Roman numerals 1, 2, 3, and 4. See those? And what those are these domains structures. So there's 6 alpha helices on the far left, designated Roman numeral 1. And then there are 6 more going to the right, designated Roman numeral 2, and then there's 6 more with Roman numeral 3, and then another 6 more Roman numeral 4. On the far right, and those are called domains. They're very similar structures, and you can see the similarities just by looking at the picture here. Okay, so they have 4 domains, and the 4th helix, the orange one there, in each of these domains, has a bunch of pluses on it. Those are all positive charges, okay? Those are all positively charged amino acids side chains. And so there are 5 on each of these with a total of 20 positive charges. Those 4 orange helices, those 20 positive charges are the voltage sensor, okay? Those are the structures that detect electrical changes here. Okay? Now, let me just say, this was taken from Professor Anna Dolphin's paper in Nature Reviews Neuroscience. She's a professor in the UK. And now, there are a couple of things about this. This model was came out about almost 10 years ago. Well, almost 10 years ago now. There are some things that have now been shown to be a little bit different now, including the fact that that some of these alpha helices, instead of going straight up and down, are actually at an angle. And those include that orange cylinder that we talked about. It's at an angle. All of those charges, every single one of them, is within the what's called the lipid bilayer of the plasma membrane. Okay, in the kind of fatty section of the plasma membrane, and the forces on those charges are much, much higher than you would expect for two different reasons, both of which come straight out of the physics. Okay, so we're just talking about basic physics here. The one thing is that it's been known since the 1780s, I guess, there was something called Coulomb's law that was discussed by Coulomb, obviously. One of the things Coulomb's law says is the forces on charged groups is inversely proportional to what's called the dielectric constant of the medium in which they occur. Okay. Now, the dielectric constant of the lipid bilayer is about 1/120th of the dielectric constant of the aqueous phase, the water and salts that are found elsewhere in the cell. Okay. So what that means is that the forces on those charges goes up by a factor of 120 because of that fact alone. And there's another fact which also makes it go up even further. The plasma membrane has a very high electrical resistance. And so electrical effects tend to be highly concentrated across the plasma membrane. They're about 3,000 times concentrated right across the plasma membrane because of that. And that was estimated by Shepard et al. In a paper that was published in 2008, a paper in which they claimed supported the idea that there couldn't be biological effects of these fields. Okay? So their position is the opposite of mine, but I'm using some information that they developed in that paper. Okay. Now, so there's about a 3,000-fold. Okay, so in total then.
One question. Is it in the body exactly in line as it was on the picture?
No. No, okay. Let's go back. No, actually, this thing is wrapped around into sort of a cylinder, okay? So it's not flat. It's wrapped around, and when those positive charges are pulled on, basically the channel that opens up is in the middle. So they're kind of wrapped around, and in the middle you open up a channel by pulling on those positive charges, and that's what opens the channel. Okay?
It's a kind of vortex.
I don't know. No, I don't think so. But it's
spiraling.
It's roughly, the point is that these four domains kind of go around in a circle. No. But no, they're in the membrane, so they just come out in this out of that dimension and circle around. That's the way they work. Okay. So So the estimate then is that compared with single forces, singly charged groups elsewhere in the cell, and those are essentially all in the aqueous phase, okay, so they're all in the water. The force on the voltage sensor is 20 times, okay, so the 20 represents the factor 20 charges, times 120, that's the dielectric constant effect, times 3,000, that's the effect of the high resistance of the plasma membrane. So they're approximately 7.2 million times stronger than singly charged groups elsewhere in the cell. All right. So basically what that means is that the calculations of industry claiming these things are, that these low-intensity fields are not strong enough to do anything, are off by a factor of something like 7.2 million. And Now, these are approximations, okay? These are not precise figures. I want to emphasize that. But they give you a good idea of how far off these things are from, you know, their calculations are from reality. And now, the same sort of reasoning then goes for the safety guidelines and standards. Safety guidelines and standards are based on heating. Heating is produced by forces on these singly charged groups elsewhere in the cell that then, when you joggle them around, they heat things. You've already said that. And so this to estimate the safety based on heating means that these safety guidelines are off by a factor of something like 7.2 million as well, okay? So it's been on the basis, on this basis, that the vast majority of the human population on Earth is being exposed to these EMFs with claims that people don't have to worry about the safety, okay? Believe it or not. Okay, so how does this whole thing work? And so here we have on the left the microwave and lower frequency EMFs activating the VGCCs and opening up a channel and increasing the level of intracellular calcium. So this is the calcium in the cell. That, you know, and it's produced, of course, by a flow of calcium through the VGCCs into the cell, into the cytoplasm of the cell. And so that's designated Ca2 plus I. That refers to intracellular calcium. And one of the things that happens as a consequence of that is that you get a big increase in nitric oxide, NO. That's what that NO is nitric oxide. That happens because two of the enzymes that make nitric oxide are calcium dependent. So they have very low activity under normal circumstances, but when you have a lot of calcium in the cell, the activity goes way up and you get a lot of nitric oxide. There was an interesting study that was published by Arthur Pilla, who showed that you take cells in culture, you can expose them to a pulse microwave field, and in less than 5 seconds, you get a big amount of nitric oxide produced. So all of that occurs extremely rapidly. Now, the nitric oxide acts along that pathway to produce cyclic GMP, and that stimulates in turn a protein kinase known as the G kinase or protein kinase G. And that produces the therapeutic effects. Okay? So this is what I said in my first paper on this. This is what Arthur Pilla, who's a real expert on this, has said in another paper that was published at almost exactly the same time. That pathway, the nitric oxide signaling pathway, is the main, possibly the sole pathway for producing therapeutic effects. Okay, so we know, or at least think we know, that we understand how the therapeutic effects work. However, when you get big increases in intracellular calcium, you not only get a big increase in nitric oxide, you also get big increases in superoxide. And that, I think there's a blue arrow there, I'm not sure you can see it. Anyway, and those two react with each other to form peroxynitrite, which is a potent oxidant. And peroxynitrite, as you can see down along the, a little lower down, can break down and form free radicals and produce oxidative and nitrosative stress. We think that the peroxynitrite, the free radicals, and the oxidative nitrosative stress all contribute to the pathophysiology, to the disease-causing effects of these EMFs. And I also think that the intracellular calcium contributes as well by producing excessive calcium signaling. So calcium signaling is a very important process in the cell. Normally it occurs only for very brief times, and then it's turned off. So you let calcium in the cell just for a little while, and you chuck it out. And but when you have excessive calcium signaling, that can also produce many different pathophysiological effects at all. So basically, those are the mechanisms which I think cause all or almost all the problems that we see in this. Now, let me just say, I'm going to show you on the next slide something that involves the DNA damage. We talked about the fact you can get single-strand breaks in cellular DNA. And those are thought to be produced by the free radicals. We know those free radicals can attack the DNA and cause and produce single-strand breaks. Okay. And so this is a study of this process. And this thing has been called a comet assay. Well, you can't see this well at all. Can we turn the lights down a little bit? Maybe we can, I can't see it. I assume you can't see it. That's fine. Let's just leave it at that for now. I can go off of here. Okay, we'll turn it back on a little bit. Now, if you look at these,
it was nice to have done. Yeah.
Oh. Just turn it off. Just turn it off. There you go. Okay. We can turn it on later. Okay. So let me just say, this came from a study that was published by Lutz and Edelhofer here in Germany, and entitled "Objections Against Current Limits for Microwave Radiation and All Those Safety Standards." We've been complaining about those for many years. Many of us have, and basically, what this was a study where they were studying these single-strand breaks produced by an exposure to 1800 megahertz. This is a continuous wave exposure. I don't know if you can read that, but it says it's a continuous wave over here. And that's more or less the equivalent of using a mobile phone or cell phone. And for 24 hours. Okay, well, we don't usually use mobile phones for 24 hours, but we sometimes use them for several hours. And this produces single-strand breaks fairly close to what happens with ionizing radiation, the equivalent of 1600 chest x-rays. So this is an extremely powerful ionizing radiation exposure. It is the equivalent of more or less equivalent of cell phone usage, okay?
What is the light ball? What is it, the white light ball?
Well, okay, so I'm going to explain that. So what's happening here is the following. You treat the cells with various things, and then you have a sham exposure, which is basically no treatment. And then you take the cells and you put them in a particular region here. That's where that circle is. And you put alkali in there. And what the alkali does is it causes the DNA is normally double-stranded. It allows the DNA now to become single-stranded for the two strands to separate from each other. And if you have a lot of breaks, what are you going to have? You're going to have small pieces of DNA. And the small pieces of DNA are small enough that they can actually migrate away from that center. And so if you put these in an electric field, and the DNA is negatively charged because of the phosphates on it, they will move to the positive pole. So the positive pole here is on the right. And what do you see? You see the DNA is moving off in that direction for the gamma radiation for something that's sort of similar to mobile phone use, but not in the sham. Okay. Now, the other thing which is done here is you use a fluorescent dye which binds to the DNA and only fluoresces when it binds to the DNA. So you can visualize where the DNA is. Now, this is what's called a comet assay because it looks at least superficially like a comet in the sky. It has its tail. Okay, the tail is a single strand break, the DNA that's been broken. Okay, So, roughly speaking, what this shows is that the mobile phone exposure can produce single-strand breaks that are of similar to a similar amount to what 1600 chest X-rays produce. But here you have a comparison between a mobile phone that has a little battery, produces a very weak field, compared with X-rays, X-ray machine, very powerful, high-powered machine, and they produce similar numbers of single-strand breaks based on this kind of criteria. Now, let me just say, this study actually underestimates the effect of the cell phone. Now, why is that? It's because it's been known for a long time that pulse fields are much more active than non-pulse fields in biological effects. And of course, all the wireless communications communicate via pulsations. Okay, so they have pulsations, up and down all the time. And so in a further study that was published later, and I just have the title on it here, but you can pull out the whole study out of PubMed database if you like. And that was done also by Adelkoffer and also by Rudinger, one of his colleagues in Austria, and several of their co-workers. And what that showed is that, in fact, the continuous wave exposure produces considerably less in the way of single-strand breaks in the DNA than a real cell phone does at the same intensity. Okay, so this thing that we see here actually considerably underestimates the activity of cell phones. Let's just leave light off for a minute here. Yeah, let's leave it off for a minute, then we can turn it back on. What I want to say here is that, so the question is, how can a cell phone, very low energy cell phone, how can a low energy cell phone produce, these huge numbers of single strand breaks in DNA compared with much, much higher energy X-ray machine? That's the central question I'm raising here. And I think the probable answer is that there are actually three levels at which you get a high level of amplification between the VGCC activation and the production of the free radicals that produce the breaks here. Okay, so first of all, when the VGCCs are activated, they open up a channel. You get about 1 million calcium ions flowing in the cell per second. So you get a huge amplification because there's so many calcium ions that flow in through each of these channels. That's number one. Number two is when you get your intracellular calcium, it has basically catalytic effects on both the nitric oxide and the superoxide production. Okay, so you have another level of amplification, and then when those two react to form peroxynitrite, the rate of the reaction is the product of the two concentrations. So it's NO times the superoxide concentration. And so you get a third level of amplification. We have three levels of amplification here. Okay, let's turn the lights back on. And so, okay, good, thank you. Now, when...
Because you had a slightly more...
A little bit higher, and you get a little bit higher.
Lower?
Oh, lower.
Okay. Oh, shit.
No, not that. All right. Okay, is that good? All right. Okay, now, when ionizing radiation produces these free radicals, it also has an amplification, but it's only at one level. So when ionizing radiation, you have these very high energy photons that go through a medium, go through the cells of your body, going through wherever they're going. They start knocking electrons out of molecules as they go along. And so you get a chain of free radicals produced. along each of these, and so that chain basically is a considerable amplification mechanism. That mechanism, by the way, was discovered by Arthur Compton, and who got the Nobel Prize for this. This is called Compton scattering. You're basically scattering free radicals behind these high energy photons, and so there is amplification there, but it's only at one level. I think that you have to explain this in terms of the difference in the amplification. And so, in fact, what seems clear from this is that there is a strong argument that these microwave frequency EMFs, in fact, are more dangerous than ionizing radiation to the body. This, of course, is exactly the opposite of what industry has been claiming for many, many years. Okay, so I have in this table a discussion of how these various things that I talked about before that have been generated by these low-intensity EMFs can be produced by that mechanism that we just discussed before. And I don't really have time to go through these, but I simply want to state that, with one exception that I'll point out as I go along, all of these can be produced through those mechanisms that I discussed, in the pathophysiology and the therapy, okay? And that includes oxidative stress, it includes single-strand breaks in the DNA, double-strand breaks in the DNA, 8-hydroxydeoxyguanosine in the DNA, cancer, in which a number of mechanisms are probably involved, breakdown of the blood-brain barrier, male and female infertility, therapeutic effects that we discussed before, the widespread neuropsychiatric effects, melatonin depletion, sleep disruption, cataract formation, the changes in the heart, which include tachycardia, bradycardia. Tachycardia is fast heartbeat, bradycardia is slow heartbeat, arrhythmia, and sometimes these may lead to sudden cardiac death. There are also heart palpitations that can be produced as well by these fields. And the hormone, the endocrine effects can be produced. Let me just say, many of the hormones in the body and all of the neurotransmitters in the body are released through the action of BGCCs and intracellular calcium, okay? So this mechanism is very closely linked to the release of many hormones and the release of neurotransmitters throughout the nervous system. Steroid hormones are not released that way, but their synthesis can be affected. And this is the one thing that is different from what I showed you in that diagram. I think this is a direct nitric oxide effect on some of the enzymes that are involved in the synthesis of the steroid hormones. And apoptosis can be produced also by these effects. So programmed cell death. So all these things can be produced essentially in this way, with the one exception that I said before. The steroid hormone effects are probably direct effects of nitric oxide acting on certain enzymes. Now this doesn't prove that all these mechanisms are in fact what's going on, although in some cases we have substantial evidence that suggests that these are right. What it does prove is that when industry supporters claim there are no possible mechanisms, that they're wrong. Okay. And that's I think very clear. And they do make those claims, as you probably know. So, okay. Now these are not the only pathophysiological effects of these EMFs, but they are among the best understood in terms of mechanisms, and they're also among the best documented in terms of occurrence. And they give you some idea of the breadth of the effects that are seen. And they document how these microwave frequency EMFs attack each of the four things we most value as individuals and as a species. That they attack our health in multiple ways. They attack our brain function. And let me just say something I haven't mentioned, I don't think, and that is, some of the early animal studies it was shown that that these non-thermal microwave frequency EMS have absolutely massive effects on the structure of animal brains. Some of these studies going back all the way to the 1950s. They attack the integrity of our genomes, and they attack our ability to produce healthy offspring. Now that, in and of itself, I think is quite stunning. And I'm going to talk about some other things that they do subsequently, okay? So, but, you know, when you think about that, it's really quite stunning that all of this stuff is going on and nobody's doing anything about it. We're almost completely anyway. Now, I want to talk a bit about electromagnetic hypersensitivity, and I know that some of you are quite interested in it. And so, cases of EHS are thought to be caused by previous exposures to EMFs, particularly microwave and radio frequency EMFs, but also, in a number of cases, other kinds of EMFs. And one of the main sources of information about possible mechanisms of EHS may be based on what we know about the mechanism of multiple chemical sensitivity, MCS. These two have a number of things in common. And so, and I think we know a lot more about MCS than we do about EHS. And again, we have certain groups that claim to the contrary, but I think the evidence is quite clear on that. And so first of all, cases of each of them can be initiated by previous exposures. Most commonly, chemicals in the case of MCS and EMS in the case of EHS. Secondly, such exposures cause high-level sensitivity responses, or at least multiple exposures may be necessary or perhaps not, depending on the individual case. MCS and EHS are often comorbid, that is, they often occur together in the same individuals. And they both involve symptoms coming from the brain and symptoms coming from the peripheral tissues. Okay? So there are different regions of the body that may produce sensitivity responses in each of them. So a lot of them involve the brain, but then there are a fair number that do not. Anyway, there's another thing I think that they have in common. There is a lot of variation in the symptoms from one individual to another, both MCS and an EHS. So, and I believe that this is because there are different tissues that are impacted in different individuals. They're not all the same. And for that reason, you see different sensitivity responses in both MCS and EHS from one individual to another. So they are heterogeneous in this way. That shouldn't be surprising, but it's something that needs to be recognized. Because otherwise, you get these weird responses where people say, oh, they're all different from each other, that it can't be true. Which, of course, is totally illogical. But, so we have now, in MCS, and I used to work on this quite a bit. There are seven classes of chemicals that are implicated in causing MCS. And each of them work along different pathways, but they end up activating these NMDA receptors. Okay? So and when you activate the NMDA receptors, what happens? You open up a channel and you allow calcium to flow into the cell, okay? And the effects, most of the effects of the NMDA activation and most of the effects of the VGCC activation go through this excessive calcium in the cell. So even though they're different, you have different targets initially, you have very similar effects. And so I think one of the sort of take-home lessons here is that sensitivity responses can be produced by excessive calcium in the cell. Okay. Now, how does it work? And I guess I've already gone through most of this, so maybe we can skip this slide. So we have these similarities, and the question is, how in fact does this play out in terms of mechanism? One of the things that can happen in
Can I just ask something?
You had a question?
Yeah. You take up the L-type calcium channels here.
Yeah.
Does that mean that you've been talking about the L-types only? Or?
No, and that's a good question. The L-type channels. There are a number of types of bolus-gated calcium channels. The L-type ones are the ones that stay open the longest. And so they are the ones that can most easily produce kind of massive changes in intracellular calcium. And so in that sense, they're more similar to the VGCCs. But there are other voltage-gated calcium channels, and they have different properties. And we really don't have time to talk about what the differences are.
Yeah, but you've been talking about all of them.
I've been talking about all of them, okay. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they're all involved in this. With one possible group being an exception because nobody's ever looked at it. Okay, everyone that's been looked at is involved here, is activated by these EMFs. Okay, all right. So so that's a good question, and thank you for it. So some of the things that that I think are going on here, and this is shown here in number 6. Is that the calcium from both the NMDA receptors and from the L-type VGCCs can stimulate what's called long-term potentiation. This is a mechanism which makes the synapses in the brain much more sensitive. So it makes them able to transmit information much more easily. Okay, and so this is a sensitivity response immediately. Okay, now this process is known to be involved in learning and memory. Okay, so it's a normal process, but obviously when you have excessive amounts of it, it can cause problems. And that's probably what's going on to some extent in both of these. And I've also argued that, as some of you know from my talk yesterday, that the what we call the neuronal cycle can be triggered by these changes, by calcium, by nitric oxide, peroxynitrite, superoxide. They all have roles in initiating the what we call the neuronal cycle, which is a local cycle that can impact cells in different parts of the body. So I think those are involved. And I think there's something else involved, and or some other things involved, and I want to just say a few words about that. But before getting into that, I want to say something about two of the observations which lead me to say that I think that EHS is a real sensitivity. Okay. One is that EHS people on exposure often develop neuropsychiatric symptoms similar to those caused by EMF exposures in the general population, just at lower intensities. So this suggests, yeah, we all respond to these things with these kinds of problems, but the EHS people are more sensitive. So that this suggests this is a real sensitivity. And so that's also true of the cardiac effects. Cardiac effects in EHS, at least some EHS people, respond to these cardiac, you know, the kinds of tachycardia and arrhythmias can be produced by very, very, very low exposures. And that's been shown in some of Magda Havas' studies. And so, again, all patients are not the same. Everybody with EHS is not the same. Some people show these cardiac effects, some people don't. Now, there's another thing here that I've been in email contact with Dr. Cornelia Waldman-Selsam in Germany over 2 weeks or so before I left the U.S. She has some very interesting observations about a particular EHS patient, and she's given me permission to talk about them, okay? But these are her observations, and I want to make sure you understand that. So she has a patient she calls S, a woman who has lost her parathyroid function due to an accident. Okay, so the parathyroid hormone is a hormone which helps control extracellular calcium levels in your blood, you know, that your cells are all bathed in, okay? Those extracellular calcium levels are generally highly regulated. And because this woman lacks parathyroid function, she lacks the normal control of extracellular calcium, okay? And what happens is, and this woman is extremely sensitive to low levels of EMF exposure. And when she is exposed to these low levels, her extracellular calcium levels drop dramatically and rapidly. Okay? And I think what this is telling us is that the VGCCs in this sensitive person are highly sensitive themselves. So we're not just talking about downstream effects of the VGCCs being sensitive. We're talking about the actual VGCCs being highly sensitive. So they apparently are regulated in such a way in the EHS people that they are very sensitive to these fields. And there are a number of regulatory mechanisms that we know can work on them. And such that when this woman is exposed to these extremely low exposures, the calcium flows into the cell, and as a consequence of that, the extracellular calcium really drops dramatically. Okay? So this is a huge effect, and I think it shows us now that EHS involves sensitivity of the VGCCs, and probably also sensitivity of some of the downstream effects to the VGCCs. And so it may be a combination of those two that leads to some of these extremely high levels of sensitivity that we see, okay? In some patients, not all. Okay, so I think this is a very important observation that tells us a lot about what's going on in this patient and suggests that similar things are going on in other individuals, except that they control their extracellular calcium much better than this person does, because she lacks the parathyroid hormone. Okay, so So that again, that suggests, you know, EHS is a real phenomenon, it has some real physiology behind it, and it involves both the sensitivity of the VGCCs to activation, but also the downstream effects, in all likelihood, of the VGCCs and producing things like neurosensitization. So, now, how are we doing for time? Huh? Okay, we're doing fine, eh? Okay, fine. Now, let me just say, you know, I've been talking about these things for about, about 8 months, maybe a little longer than that. There are several things that concern me about this whole phenomenon that I think, when taken together, lead us to really quite drastic concern for our whole situation here with these EMFs. And so what I want to do is talk about five things which I have labeled worst-case scenarios. I think all of these are quite plausible. And if they come to pass, the combination of even two or three of these will undoubtedly have absolutely drastic effects on our species. Let me say before I get into those, you know, we are in a situation where we're seeing, again, ever-increasing exposures, okay? We know from things that I haven't discussed that when you have exposure to a particular level of a particular EMF over longer time periods, the effects get more and more severe over time. And that's been shown both in animal studies and in humans. Okay. So now we don't have a lot of studies of that type, but the ones that we have are really, I think, quite convincing that that is the case. But we're looking at ever-increasing exposures, and we don't have the foggiest idea what that's going to do, except it's going to be really bad. And one issue, and there are 10 research groups who've argued that the autism epidemic is probably caused to a great extent by EMF exposures. Okay, and I discussed last year at the Autism One meeting in Chicago some mode of action which I think can explain autism. And let me just say, before going into that, I want to say we know that excessive activity of the VGCCs can cause autism. We know that from rare mutations. We also know that elevated activity of the main L-type VGCC in the brain has a role in causing autism in the broader autism population. And that's because there's a polymorphism in that gene, which is associated with increased incidence of autism. Okay, and so that particular form of the gene produces more of the protein, of the VGCC protein, and it has a higher, and those people have a higher incidence of autism. So that process can go on. And if you look at this sequence on the left side of this thing, where you have a microwave and lower frequency EMFs activating the VGCCs, increasing intracellular calcium, and then coming back and impacting synapse formation, that sequence of events has been supported by 32 different types of evidence arguing that these things occur and that they have roles in autism, okay? And I obviously don't have time to talk about this. It took me an hour to talk about it in Chicago last year. But among the things which are affected are actually 5 different processes. I only have 4 listed here that influence the formation and the function of the synapses. Okay, so there is very good reason to know that autism, that the problem in autism has to do with the synapse formation and function in these young children, that then leads to further changes in the synapses as they grow older. Okay, and so the synapses, which of course are the ways through which, you know, one neuron speaks to another, are dysfunctional. All of these processes are regulated by calcium. All of them can be disrupted by excessive calcium. They can also be disrupted by inadequate calcium. And by inappropriate levels of calcium. So I think that's the main mechanism of the autism epidemic. But there are also chemical effects going through calcium. And you can see that over there, and I've already discussed the NMDA receptors and their role in responding to chemicals. So, you know, we may well be in a situation. You know, the last figure in the U.S. for autism was about 1 birth in 68. That was for people born in 2002. Here we are in 2016, and with ever-increasing autism, with ever-increasing exposures, we don't have the foggiest idea what the figure's going to be. It could be easily 1 in 20, 1 in 10, even 1 in 5 might be reasonable estimates. So this could be an absolutely horrendous situation already. It's just we don't know it yet. Now, let's go on. Now, the neuropsychiatric effects I told you about, but I haven't really shown you what they are. These are the main ones. And these occur, you know, and these have been shown to occur in response to many different types of EMF exposures. And these are, you know, becoming more and more common in the population. And so I think these are already extremely common problems in our societies in much of the world. This is now. These aren't the only things that have been reported. These are the ones that have been reported repeatedly, and I think are established effects. But there are many others that have been reported less frequently that I don't think can be considered established, but still are likely. Some of these are likely to occur. So the grand total of things are probably goes well beyond this list. Worst case scenario number three, sterility, spontaneous abortion, reproduction goes to zero. Well, maybe not quite all the way to zero, but pretty close. I talked to you a bit before about male and female infertility being caused and also spontaneous abortion. Magras and Zinos, a couple of researchers in Greece, published a paper now almost 19 years ago, never been repeated, that shows that pairs of mice made it at two exposure levels in what's called an antenna park. So this is a series of broadcasting antennas where you have, the levels, the exposure levels at ground level were all well within our current safety standards. So current safety standards say nothing should happen, there shouldn't be any problem. What they found was that at the higher, and so they put these, they had these in little cages, and they put them, exposed them at two areas, one with a somewhat higher level of exposure, some with a somewhat lower level. Mice go through gestation in about a month, so they can produce a litter in a month, and then mate again, produce another little litter, 5 or 6 weeks later, and so forth. So what happened at the higher level exposure, they went through two successful pregnancies, they produced litters, and then they were completely sterile, absolutely nothing. At the lower level, it took about 4.5 months, and then they were completely sterile. So, I find it amazing that this has never been repeated. I think that this is, this was a huge, a warning signal, I think, and it's quite possible that we will have plummeting fertility, drops of maybe 60%, 80%, 90%, what happens when we don't have another generation? This is basically what we're saying. Worst case scenario number four, germline mutations. Okay, so we know microwave fields are genotoxic. They produce widespread DNA damage in cells. We know the germlines are heavily impacted by these EMFs. So the germlines, of course, are the ones that produce, that pass our genomes to the next generation. So the germline cells are heavily impacted. We know that there are three studies which studied mutations in the germline and have shown that there are increases in these after exposure, mutational increases after exposure, and I've got the citations here. And so we could well be destroying our genomes. But in any case, we are almost certainly going to be, passing on a larger number of mutations to future generations. And let me just say, when you look at the autism situation, that also has a role in autism. There is a substantial role of what are called de novo mutations, mutations that are found in the autism patients that were not present in either of their parents. What that says about autism is that the EMFs in the parental EMF exposures may have important roles, as well as the exposures during pregnancy and after birth of the child. So things get more and more complex and more worrisome. And So worst case scenario number five is an epidemic of premature Alzheimer's disease. We are seeing an unexplained epidemic of premature Alzheimer's and early onset dementias. We know that, number one, early onset neurodegenerative diseases are becoming more and more common. And so let me say, I have this reference. There's a new study that came out just a few weeks ago that showed even more clearly that this is true, particularly in the U.S. And there are epidemiological studies that have shown that occupational exposures to extremely low-frequency EMFs, such as from our power lines, increase Alzheimer's incidence. And those, is, of course, as I've already mentioned, they also work by the BGCCs, okay? So that suggests that BGCC activation can lead to increased Alzheimer's. High levels of calcium, intracellular calcium, have very important roles, both in Alzheimer's and also in the other neurodegenerative diseases as well. Okay, and there are higher BGCC activity. So this is the same polymorphism that I told you about before, is associated with increased incidence of autism. Okay? So now you say, well, okay, all of those suggest things, but they're not quite a red flag. Well, maybe they. There's a fascinating study that came out of China that was published by Zhang et al., where they showed that young rats exposed to multiple short pulses of microwave EMS developed, as middle-aged rats, oxidative stress, high levels of the amyloid beta, the A-beta protein. Okay, so the A-beta protein is characteristic of Alzheimer's, is known to have an important causal role in Alzheimer's. And here, that's highly elevated. And they also have cognitive memory impairment. And these are as middle-aged rats. And rats are not a species known to have Alzheimer's in the past. And here, they're coming down with something that looks very much like Alzheimer's disease, simply because they're exposed to a series of pulse microwave fields as human rats. Okay. You know, and one of the things that I think, and that was published in this study. Here, I give you the citation here. Now, Alzheimer's typically has a very long latency period, and so you know, typically, if you have a stressor like head trauma, for instance, which tends to cause increased Alzheimer's, Alzheimer's actually develops 25 or 30 years later. Okay? So it takes a long time for this whole thing to develop. So it may well be that we're looking at the effects of EMFs that occurred 25 years ago, not the effects of EMFs now, which of course are vastly, vastly higher. If that's true, and I don't know that it's true, I hope the hell it's not true, that we may be seeing, if we stop all exposures tomorrow, we may be seeing an epidemic that may be coming on from these earlier exposures over the next 25 years that may show, may have produce an absolutely gigantic increase in early onset dementias. Okay? Now we're seeing, let me say, we're seeing dementias coming in now. They're still rare. And people of age 30. Absolutely unheard of before. Okay? So that may be an absolutely gigantic increase. Now, I don't know that that's the case. I hope it isn't. But you get some idea of the fact that we're just ignoring things of absolutely horrendous possible proportions. All through very plausible mechanisms. Okay. So, you know, so what we're looking at here, now let me go back. Okay, so, you know, and I mean, you know, look at this scenario. What five of these things occur? What happens? You have this dramatic decline in reproduction. Among the few people who were born, many of them have autism. Probably all of them have ADHD, which kind of is more common than autism. Of those tiny number, perhaps, that don't, you may have, many of them are going to develop neuropsychiatric diseases, because we're seeing that already all over the place. And many of them then may develop very early onset dementias. I guess I'm kind of speechless when I think about this. There's no guarantee, of course, that all those things are going to happen. But they may happen. They are all plausible. And even only two or three of those happen, we're in very, very deep trouble. I think the neuropsychiatric stuff is already happening, and we see it all the time, and I don't think there should be a question about that one. So, anyway, what do we need to do? We absolutely need to move rapidly in this area. In the U.S., I think we need to repeal the 1996 Telecommunications Act. I don't know whether you have anything equivalent here in Sweden. We need to stop these ever-increasing levels of exposures. There are many, many ways in which these devices can be made much safer. But we're currently running as fast as we can in exactly the wrong direction. We need biologically relevant safety standards. And I've discussed these in a number of different situations, including at the Parliament earlier today. There are ways to develop these, but currently there's no action to actually develop them. I think cells and culture could be used to look at the VGCC activation in response to various fields, and this could be done quite easily. There may be other ways to do biologically relevant safety test standards as well, to do the testing. And so that's kind of where we are. And I thank you. Thank you.